Welcome again to another session of Senior Moments with the old question mark. Now, of course, we know what the question mark is. We don't have senior moments. We actually have intellectual pauses. Right, everybody? Supposed to laugh. That's good. That's better. That's better. All right. Today's program is going to be on affordable housing and dealing with the North Shore and Beverly and some state issues. And before we get into that, I want to mention that NASCAP is now taking applications for fuel assistance. And the number, hopefully they're going to put it up on the screen, but it's 978-531-8810. Now, you want to try on this. Now, here's the minimums. If you're an individual, the cutoff point is $34,380. So get paper and pencil, because I might have some other stuff that's important to you. So if you are under that amount of income coming in for the year, you will qualify for fuel assistance. And the average that you will get is between $800 and $1,000, most likely. Okay. Now, if you're a couple, the cutoff is $44,958. So if the total income, again, is for the year, is under that amount of money, go for it. Just give them a call. There's one other thing I wanted to do. I can't think of what it is. All right, today we're very lucky. We have two people that are extremely knowledgeable in the area of affordable housing. First, to my far left, is Shelley Gehring. And she is Program Director for Community Development for Mass Housing Partnership. And that's a nonprofit organization. And I'll let her tell you, you know, what she does. And right next to me on my left is Andrew DeFrenza. And this is the second time I've had Andrew on. He's just all over the place. Most of you already know him. He's CEO of Harborlite, which is located right across from Kelleher's Pond. And he's going to tell us all about what Harborlite does. And he's got some very good news in comparison to the last time I had him on, I guess, it's about 3 months ago? Okay. So, Shelley, before we get into the program itself, I got a quiz and some jokes. So, Shelley, when and where was the first affordable housing done in Massachusetts? Now,
under which program?
I got this wrong. He asked me to the first answer.
I asked Andrew this.
Was it public housing?
Public housing.
Public housing?
Yeah.
And it's not Boston?
No.
So why would you ask it?
Because you can walk to it from here.
Oh, it's in Beverly?
It's a quarter of a mile away up Tozier Road. Okay.
How do you know this?
How do I know this?
How do you know this?
Because I'm a Beverlyite.
Actually,
the way I found it out, I called Catholic Charities doing some research on what they're doing in affordable housing. And they informed me it's Northridge, right up the road. And it's also the first co-op.
So it's not public housing, if it's a co-op.
Huh?
It's not public.
So it's private or a nonprofit.
Oh. Huh. It was
interesting. Non-co-op.
Okay. So, and Andrew, I already covered his question is, we know you can build a house in one day if it's prefab. I said, how else can you build a house in one day? And so we had a little discussion on it. Andrew, what is it?
I said I didn't know, and you said that 3D printing was a possibility, and then I mentioned that I had seen that.
Shelley, do you know anything about 3D printing?
Well, I didn't know you could do an entire house that you could live in.
Yeah. And you can do up to three to four stories.
Wow.
Although it's better that you only do one. Right now. I mean, this is the technology of the future, but I think it has a tremendous amount of potential, particularly as it pertains to affordable housing. So I would just suggest you keep your eye on that.
Okay,
jokes. What do you get when you step on a live wire?
He's asking you, I don't know.
What?
A pair of shocks.
Oh, right.
So, this husband's wife told him that she's lost the spark. So what do you think the husband did to his wife?
There's no good answer to this question.
He had her step on a live wire?
He tased her.
Oh, boy.
Mm. All right, enough for the jokes.
Yeah.
See, now nobody laughed at that. That means...
Yeah, that's not funny. That's
not funny.
No.
Well, it could be the other way around. I mean, she could accuse him that he had no spark and tased him.
I think if you want to tase each other, then the relationship's over.
Well, there's a lot of strange things that go on in households. All right, Shelley, tell us about MHP. Once again, that's Mass Housing Partnership.
Yep, so Mass Housing Partnership MHP, is a quasi-state agency. So we also have tax-exempt status. We are a nonprofit, but we're a quasi-state agency. So we work with the state departments, but we are independently, privately funded.
You keep them honest?
We work closely with them. And so our organization, we're all about increasing affordable housing across the state of Massachusetts. So in every community, we want to see more housing that's affordable to a wider variety of people. So we do that in a few different ways. One, we've lent out over $1 billion of funds that have helped create thousands of units of affordable housing.
Where did you get your funding?
So originally, MHP started as a program of the state's housing agency, DHCD, the Department of Housing and Community Development. Mm-hmm. And then it was spun off after a few years. This was 30 or so years ago. And the initial funding came from legislation that was passed that required banks that bought Massachusetts banks to contribute funds to MHP to be able to lend out for affordable housing. So that was the initial funding. And now we also access FHA and other loan products that we can then lend out to developers in Massachusetts. So we've helped to finance housing development, and then we also have the One Mortgage product, which I know you're familiar with.
About that. Mm-hmm. Right.
So the One Mortgage product is the most affordable mortgage product in Massachusetts for households earning up to 100% of the area median income. And households that earn up to 80% can receive additional subsidy that make the mortgage even more affordable in the initial years. Thousands of people have benefited from this mortgage over the last, I think that's been 25 or so years. Perhaps 30. And part of what makes it more affordable is even though the borrower receives the mortgage through a traditional lender, through banks or credit unions, MHP manages kind of the back of the house, and MHP sets aside some funds to cover any kind of private mortgage insurance. So a borrower does not need to pay private mortgage insurance because this money is set aside that if there is a default, that a bank can pull on it. But the default rate is extremely low. So it just means that more moderate income households can access more house because they're not having to pay the private mortgage insurance, which can cut off $200 or $300 more a month. The interest rate is low, it's fixed for 30 years. So that's the second piece that we do towards helping more people access housing in Massachusetts. And then the third is my department, which is community assistance. So we have a team of folks that work in communities all around the state. We also work with housing authorities and nonprofit organizations who are trying to create more affordable housing.
And cities like Beverly.
That's right,
cities like Beverly. That's where I first ran into Shelley. I went down to the Affordable Housing Trust Committee. I was having a meeting, and there was Shelley, Consultant Shelley.
Right, so my work specifically is to help affordable housing trusts around the state. So many communities have created a trust, but there just isn't any statewide support for trusts. But
you also help nonprofits like Andrew.
Exactly, yeah. So my work was, I came on a little over a year ago, specifically to create some statewide support for trusts. So I'm going to be in Western Mass tomorrow and on Wednesday, working with some trusts out there, but I have been at a few different Beverly Affordable Housing Trust meetings.
Right.
And so in Beverly, because your trust is new, then you have some staff at the city who are helping the trust to be thoughtful about how they're going to operate and what their priorities are going to be.
And
so
you've also recommended that they keep a close look on Somerville, which seems to be ahead of the curve right now. In that area as far as cities and towns?
Well, Somerville has had an affordable housing trust for many years, so it's not a new thing for them.
Right.
It's just that they only more recently passed the Community Preservation Act. So in Beverly, you passed the Community Preservation Act first, and then a trust was created just this year, whereas in Somerville, they've had a trust for 10 or 15 years, for many years, and then they just passed the Community Preservation Act. Actually, it might have been the same year as Beverly in 2012. So Somerville just has a little bit of a head start with trusts. They've been doing that for a lot longer. But then they've had other tools to bring in funds as well without the Community Preservation Act. So in Beverly, you've created a trust, and now the trustees are thinking through what are going to be the funding sources. You actually already have some funding in your trust account.
Right. And that's because when a developer does a project, okay, a certain percent of that is supposed to be set aside for affordable housing, but they can get out of that by paying a penalty.
They can pay it in lieu of payment.
Now, I have a question on that. Is that the city's choice, or can the city make them do the 20%?
Well, so if it's an inclusionary zoning, it depends on how the bylaw or the ordinance is written. But several communities allow an in lieu of payment, and sometimes it might be, there might be certain parameters put on of why you can pay out or when you can pay out or not. And I'm not familiar with Beverly's, so I can't speak specifically to Beverly's.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I personally don't like it. I would like to see every project done have some affordable housing, but that's me. Okay, they also...
Well, sometimes, though, if it's home ownership, it can be challenging. If the market rate is really high-end, it can be difficult to have affordable condos in the same building because of condo fees. There are some circumstances can make sense to do it separately.
It does, but I think it can also lead to some other issues. Mm-hmm. But
work with organizations like Harbor Light. We try to support nonprofits like Andrew's, and we actually acknowledged Andrew this last June as a housing hero. Well, Andrew and Harbor Light at our Housing Institute that we hold in Devens every June. Yes, so
I didn't know that was coming
up. So congratulations to Andrew, but wanting to acknowledge Harbor Light's very important role on the North Shore of helping to diversify housing options and build affordable housing.
He's a legend in the North Shore pertaining to housing.
Pertaining to housing. Mm. He's well known.
It's a small group.
Well, he's passionate, he's focused, and he's trying to do the right thing.
He is doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. and he's persistent, and he's a living testimony of a miracle.
That's a strong statement. You shouldn't respond to that.
Wow. I'm speechless.
Yeah. So, that's pretty much what you guys do. And I can see where you are challenging the state to do quality work.
Well, we also work a little bit with policy, and so trying to urge and push changes in zoning statewide that would require multifamily housing
in
every community.
On the firing line, I would think, you know, your input would be, you know, tremendous for the legislature.
So we do contribute it. We also work with other partners like CHAPA, a nonprofit organization that does a lot of policy work for around housing. MACDC that supports smaller nonprofit developers. And so we have different partners that work statewide as well, specifically on policy. And then we do a lot of work with housing authorities. So a lot of housing authorities around the state have surplus land, and they'd like to add units to those, to that land. So we have staff at MHP that help to help housing authorities work through that, because there's quite a process working with HUD on the federal level.
Is it only new projects, or with like the Beverly Housing Authority, do you help them get funding for rehab? Because a lot of Beverly's units are very old. We're going back to 70s and whatever.
Well, so some of the executive directors of housing authorities have some state resources that they can apply with if they also use some local funds as matching funds. So we would potentially work with executive directors with that a little bit, but our primary technical assistance is around using surplus land for new construction.
Very good. Okay, Andrew is just sitting here. Before he falls asleep, maybe we'll get him involved. Harbor Light. A lot of the audience knows Harbor Light, but a lot does not. So would you just give us an overview of like when it started and where it is, affiliation with First Baptist and so forth?
Sure. So Harbor Light.
Thank you, Shelley.
Yeah. Shelley's great. MHP is great. So we really appreciate them. And thank you, Bob, for bringing them on. So Harbor Light Community Partners is a nonprofit housing organization, and we're really the descendant of the First Baptist Church in Beverly's housing mission. That's the way that they viewed it. And they started doing that in the early 1960s. Their first project was Harbor Lighthouse, just up the street, right behind the Central Fire Station. And we're still actually a subsidiary of the church, though the board is now community-based and broad. But that's where it started. So it's been 55 years or so.
So now you're right across from Kelleher's Pond.
Well, we have some buildings over there. Our office is we rent space from the School for the Deaf campus, across from the ice cream place by Cummings.
Yep.
And we have some buildings, Turtle Creek and Turtle Woods, off of Route 22, just up past Keller's Pond. But the offices are on.
Tell me about the YMCA.
So the YMCA, great partners on the North Shore. They have a really historically significant building on Cabot Street in Beverly. It has currently 45 SRO units. They all have their own bathrooms, but they have a shared kitchen facility. And the Y is doing a big and quite excellent rehab and renovation project of their facility at the Sterling Center up off of Route 22. So they're moving all of their child care and most of their programming to that site. So we've proposed in partnership with the Y, this is the Y's project, HCP is just helping them to renovate that building on Cabot Street, add a floor, clean up some of the stuff off the roof, and add 24 units while also improving the existing units.
I had a lot of great moments playing in that gym when
many people did.
When I was a child.
Yes, yeah. My daughter plays basketball, and I coach her team, and we practiced there last winter. So of course you can't make a shot from the baseline because the roof comes in. But yes. Yeah, so we're hoping that'll be 69 units. All of the units would then have kitchenettes.
And the beautiful thing is it's right downtown.
Yeah, it's a great space for that.
So, I mean, people can just walk out the door and walk right into their work.
Right.
I mean, it's it's like...
Right. Close to the train, buses right there.
How did that project originate? You know, who had the idea on that or whatever?
Well, the Y has been doing housing a long, long time.
Right.
And they've been doing it there for a long time. So we got together with them to talk about what the next iteration of that building might be. Interestingly enough, Harbor Light and the Y had some long-term connection. The last time that building was renovated, the Cabot YMCA Harbor Light House, which I mentioned earlier, was also being renovated in the late 90s.
Uh-huh.
And actually, the residents of Harbor Light House lived at the Y for a little while Harbor Light House was getting renovated the last time. So each of those projects was due for renovation. We just did Harbor Light House a couple years ago.
It was a natural.
It was a natural. And they were interested in expanding and doing some different things, so
we talked about it. Now, also in Beverly, you're going to be doing Tozier Sawyer Road project.
I hope so. Yeah.
No, you're already involved in that, right?
I am. I am involved, but we have a ways to go yet, but yes.
Well, yeah, it's still in the development. So what's that, about 3 years off?
I would think at least, yeah. Hopefully we'll start permitting it next year if all goes well.
Okay.
So which project is that?
This is a 40... Is that okay that I answer her question, Bob?
Yeah, in fact, it's right on the other side of the high school up in the hill, right in that corner.
Really close.
But this is the 40R.
This is the 40R.
Okay, but has the 40R not been created yet, or has it?
It's in process.
It's in process,
so we just got today the letter from the state. The letter of eligibility from the state came today. So the planning board and the city council will hear that over the next month or so.
Mm-hmm.
And then hopefully there'll be a vote before year end. We have site control. We have an option to buy it, so we're hoping to buy it late December or early January.
And that's going to be mixed.
75 mixed income units, all twos and threes at this point, two and three bedroom units.
Rental?
All rental.
Rental. Mm-hmm.
With a set aside for formerly homeless families and some services on site for those folks. It's pretty cool, actually.
That's fantastic.
Really cool. And a lot of leadership at the city council level and from the mayor's office.
I mean, you got high school, you've got middle school, you got a hospital, all within walking distance.
Yeah.
Bus stop right out front.
Yeah.
It's pretty excellent. Yeah.
So have you looked at any other sites in Beverly? I'm concerned about clustering. I don't see anything in Beverly Farms. I don't see anything in Centerville. I don't see anything really in North Beverly.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what's going on? Is there discrimination going on in Beverly concerning housing, Andrew?
I would probably not have any comment on that today, Bob, but I appreciate the setup. Now, I think a lot of the reasons the housing is in certain areas is that the transportation is clustered in those areas, the work centers are clustered in those areas. You certainly could do housing in those other areas, but there's much less infrastructure, less access to transportation.
That's just another personal...
Yep, no, I hear you.
...pet peeve with me.
I'd be happy to look in Beverly Farms if that comes up.
Yeah, then half the people in the area won't like them anymore.
Might be true. I'm going to tell them it was your idea, though.
Yeah, that's all right. That's all right. Okay, we ran out of time a little bit, but has any progress been made in Hamilton? Before you answer that question, just so everybody knows, there's a 10% threshold that every community has to meet. It's a minimum threshold as far as affordable housing. Okay. Beverly happens to be uno number one in affordable housing. That's a good thing. Okay, but now we have some neighbors like Hamilton that are at 0.3. Not so good. They have procrastinated year in and year out for a long time. They're keeping, and it's obvious, affordable housing out. It's even so bad that a number of pastors in Wenham and Hamilton have gotten together and they're saying it's an issue. So it's a moral issue. Now what happens is people that are born and raised in Hamilton and Wenham are, they, you know, they're retired and they want to stay. Okay? But they can't. They're being forced out. Mm-hmm. Where do they go? Beverly. So I've already called the mayor out on this program before. I'm calling pastors out to the fact that churches do not badmouth other churches. Cities don't badmouth other cities. But this is a moral issue and should be dealt with. Beverly taxpayers should not be hit with an extra burden to take care of, particularly Hamilton, Wenham, and Manchester by the Sea. All right, so anyway, we're down to 2 minutes, Andrew. Tell me the good news on Hamilton.
Well, first, what I would just like to say is that the issue with the housing and the housing needs is all across the state. It's particularly pronounced in the greater Boston area. And this is something that Boston faces as well, because communities outside of Boston aren't doing their fair share of housing construction that's more moderate income,
totally,
and multifamily housing.
Totally,
so it's not just Beverly, it's also Boston, it's Cambridge, it's Somerville as well. So that's why there's so much work and initiatives going on, urging, pushing, supporting all communities to be supporting and allowing multifamily housing.
Are you familiar with the word shaming?
That's one way to do it. And then
I am a proponent of shaming rather than, I mean, we got federal, you know, the Republicans and the Democrats going around in a circle. Okay, it's time to call a spade a spade. All right, so anyway, Andrew, tell me good news. There's good news in Hamilton.
There is some good news. The Hamilton Affordable Housing Trust voted a couple of weeks ago to put some pretty substantial funding into one project that would be 20 units of housing for elders downtown in Hamilton.
From their CPA?
From their housing trust, which originated with their CPA, yes.
Right.
And then they voted to put another chunk of money toward a family project that was between 20 and 40 units in size. And they're going to be discussing that again Wednesday night this week.
Maple Street?
Long Meadow. Maple Street is the project in Wenham that we got permitted and had great community support. We were appealed by 12 residents in Wenham, and that's still in court. It's been in court 27 months. But the Hamilton folks, they're working hard, and there's a number of them that have been very supportive, and they took actually real action in the last month.
So something might happen up there before I go to the pie in the sky?
Boy, I hope so, Bob. I don't want to think about that.
Well, it went awful fast, but anyway, we're out of time. Any last quick comments from you two?
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, right. Thank you.
It's great.
Nice to be here.
All right. So anyway, affordable housing, thanks for joining us. And I'm Bob Butterworth. Until we meet again.
The New Year's Eve, we did the town. The day we tore the goalpost down.